1882, Friedrich Nietzsche suggested God is dead. And that brought humanity to the modern age of science and technology, and unfortunately also a sense of hubris, arrogance, that there is nothing more intelligent than us in the universe. And I think we desperately need a sense of modesty, humility. Of course, traditional religions provided that with the image of God being a superhuman entity that is far more powerful than us humans. But when you push that aside, the question, you know, you start believing that we are the most powerful things in nature, and people have no regrets eating animals that are less intelligent than we are in restaurants on the menu. But and we are about to enter a new phase right now where we produce artificial intelligence systems that might supersede human intelligence, the cognitive abilities of that could bring a sense of humility and awe at something, you know, this is like a technological kid that we produced that is smarter than us. Like your, you know, I feel with my daughters sometimes that they're much better than I am. Yeah. This case, it's technology based and AI systems that we produce. And there is another form of AI, which is alien intelligence that we may encounter. Yes. And for example, the human brain is using up 20% of the metabolic power of the human body.
Yes, yes.
So the human brain grew to become the biggest possible, given the amount of power that is produced by the food we eat and so forth. And when we deal with creatures that or entities that are intelligent that were made around other stars, you know, it's possible they have bigger brains because they have bigger bodies or some other evolutionary reason. And in that case, they would be far more intelligent than we are. They have more neural connections. So just like advanced AI systems, they could already biologically be much more intelligent than we are. And there is a selection effect that those that will come to visit us before we visit them are probably more advanced than we are because we never went outside the solar system. Yeah. So if we see those that are the most accomplished students in our class of intelligent civilizations visiting us, we will get a sense of modesty. We will be filled with awe, similar to religious awe of something that is more powerful than we. And that's what I hope for, frankly, because I very often, when reading the news every day, I get frustrated, disappointed by what I see. It's like being in a party where the attendees of the party are misbehaving. And the only thing you can hope for is looking through the window, hoping for a guest that will change the situation. So I'm hoping that we will encounter a more advanced civilization because they will give us a better role model for how to behave. Right. And they would inspire us to put our priorities in a different place than just killing each other or protecting ourselves from others killing us. I mean, if you just think about where $2.4 trillion a year are allocated to military budgets, it's all about, you know, military threats, about disputes on territories, on this rock that we were born on, and, you know, the real estate that we find on this earth is really meaningless compared to how much real estate there is up there, outside, right, in outer space.
Yeah,
so when we realize that there are other neighbors that represent other territories that represent more accomplishments than we currently possess, it may change our priorities. And also, we would realize that we are all in the same boat here on Earth, so we better work together, we better cooperate, because there is a neighbor out there that, you know, could be a threat or could be an inspiration to all of us. So I think my hope is it will bring humanity to a better place where we would be more cooperative. We will look up instead of down on each other. And it will give us a sense of awe, that a sense of humility that is required for us to grow rather than be so proud of ourselves. There is another issue, which is that there could be existential threats on Earth, either because of self-inflicted wounds, you know, like
yes,
wars
yes,
or
yes,
climate change or something hitting the earth. So we better go into space and preserve part of humanity. And it's not, the solution is not to go to Mars or the moon, because Mars is just another rock with much worse conditions. You know, it's a desert, doesn't have an atmosphere. If you just live on the surface, your body is bombarded by cosmic rays and your health will deteriorate within a matter of years. And why should we go to a worse place? You know, like, so my proposal is to build a space habitat that we control, that can accommodate humans under controlled conditions. So we started in the jungles of Africa. We ended up in high rises in cities. The next step is to go from high rises in cities to space, on a space platform that accommodates people, that, you know, has perhaps artificial gravity by rotation, a spin of the spacecraft, that has all the conditions comfortable for life as we know it. But it needs to be a big platform, and it may be expensive, but if instead of investing $2.4 trillion in military budgets a year, if we invested $1 trillion in space in architects, in engineers, in scientists that will think about a space habitat, how to build it, I think by the end of this century, we should be able to do it. It's just a question of priorities. Why should we keep, firing weapons at each other rather than working together to go elsewhere within the cosmos? If we don't realize it, we deserve not to stay around as a civilization. You know, the universe would not care about us because there were probably other civilizations that went away, you know, like they lived for a while,
yes,
and then
just
some catastrophe killed them, and we don't even know about it. The universe will continue its course, you know, even the earth will recover from humanity and will continue to exist until the sun will engulf the earth. Everything changes, but you know, it's important for us to leave a signature, leave something behind, and for that purpose it's better if we think bigger than just engaging in conflicts with each other and just, you know, explore space. But if we don't do it, we certainly deserve not to survive for very long, because we just were not worthy of thinking bigger, you know.
Beautiful.
I was asked actually just a few weeks ago for putting my essays on medium.com that I have every day or two, putting them under a paywall. And I said, no, I'm not willing to do that, because it's work of love. I don't want to make money out of it and restrict access to those. For me, I enjoy communicating with the public, enjoy the process of doing science, and it has nothing to do with making a living out of it. It's something I would do irrespective, as long as I have food. I don't need a lot. You know, I jog every morning at sunrise, and I don't care what people say. I don't have any footprint on social media. That also is important for maintaining a good health. Mental health is not paying attention to what other people are saying, just doing what sounds like the right thing. And I'm really pleased that it appeals to the public, and that it resonates with a lot of people.
It does.
And to me, you know, the most surprising part of my life was that I realized that, you know, I'm just trying to say what sounds like common sense, but I realized that common sense is not common, especially in academia. So that's what allowed me to get tenure, to publish 1,000 scientific papers or more than that, 9 books, and get recognized. It's the fact that what I find to be simple and straightforward and common sense is not being done by other people. And that is a surprise, because how would I know if other people would not think the same way? And not only that, but some people are attacking me, which is even better, because it means that they would never be able to deny that I was the first to come up with these ideas. If they were not attacking me, they could have used these ideas and advocated these ideas themselves. So people would have forgotten that I was the first one to suggest them. But the fact that they attack me is a blessing, because then it's clear that, you know, it was my idea. Mm-hmm. So in fact, being, you know, advocating for things that are not necessarily popular is a blessing, because it allows me to make a useful contribution, which otherwise would not be made,
yeah.
And also distinguishes what I'm doing from, and what I tell young people very often is,
yeah,
when you go to the beach, you see all these seashells that were swept ashore, and you can tell the difference between relatively young seashells that were just swept ashore recently and those that existed for a while on the beach, because those that were for a while, they lost their color by rubbing against each other, whereas the new ones that just came off on shore, they still have their unique colors. And so my advice to young people, you know, don't rub against other people all the time, because you would lose your unique colors. And that's why social media is not good for you, because you're becoming similar to others when you are seeking approval, when you are trying to get as many likes as possible. So maintain your colors, your beautiful colors that you were born with, and not surrender to peer pressure, to what others are saying.